Cool. Hey, I'm John Bollinger with Premier Guitar. I'm in Nashville, Tennessee with Doyle Bramhall II. Man, thanks for taking the time to meet us.
Yeah, of course. Thanks for being here.
Absolutely. Man, tell me about this guitar. Fans have seen you with, I mean, this is the one you've had for like long back, right?
Yeah, I've had this one since 2000. I actually bought this and two other Marshall, like 68 Plexi Super Basses.
Oh, wow.
I bought them all on the same day, and I was at Norm's Guitars in Los Angeles. And my friend, who's also a big guitar dealer out there, Albert, he saw this guitar on the wall and he said, "You have to buy this."
Yeah.
He's like, "Whatever you do, you have to get this guitar." And the reason I was attracted to it at first was because it's so light.
Right.
It's actually probably about 7 pounds, and other Strats are like, you know, 7.8, almost 8 pounds.
What so year is this?
Super light. This is a 64.
Wow.
And I just recently took off the back plate and noticed that it was made on the exact same date that my my daughter was born. So
wow,
pretty cool.
That's yeah, that was meant to be.
Yeah.
Yeah. And you like you're one of the fat strings on the bottom. I mean, you play it, you know, true like right-handed flipped over.
Right.
Wow.
Yeah, it gets a little complicated. Like when people say, "Oh, you played like Jimmy." But Jimmy actually played a right-handed guitar strung left-handed.
Right.
And I play a right-handed guitar strung, a left-handed guitar strung right-handed.
Yeah. Yeah, that is, I think Eric Gales does that too.
I think Eric does.
I think you're the only guys I know. And it's a very unique sound. Like, I mean, bends are kind of different and the approach is different.
Yeah.
It's really cool.
Yeah, I mean, Eric Gales, he sort of defies physics the way he plays
right?
in general, just the way he plays guitar, but especially left-handed upside down.
Yeah, it's baffling to watch.
Yeah,
you know?
It's baffling for me.
Oh, really? Even you, you're watching, you're like...
Yeah, I grew up listening to Albert King and Otis Rush. I would go to shows.
Your dad played them, right?
Not them in particular, no, but
Freddie King, was it?
He'd play with Freddie, yeah.
That's, okay, sorry, I got my kings confused.
There are lots of kings
in
the South.
Three kings.
There's Earl King.
Oh, right, okay, right? Four kings.
Freddie, BB, Albert.
Yeah.
And probably many more.
Yeah.
But yeah, so once I started playing this guitar, I couldn't really play any other Strat after that. And this one has a really small neck on it. It's 64, but it even feels smaller than the other 64s that I've played. So
I
maybe the guy who was sanding that day sanded it down a bit.
Because it was a special order left-handed, maybe the guy that ordered it wanted it smaller.
I'm not sure.
I mean, because that was a total, custom order to have a left-handed back then. So they might have, who knows? That's cool though, man. And is it all stock except for the nut, I guess?
I mean, everything is stock except for I just replaced this knob. And I refretted it because the frets were sort of small and worn.
Yeah.
Worn down.
Well, high mileage on
Yeah,
that.
So I put jumbo frets in it, on it.
Cool. Still the three-way switch? On the
pickups. I kept the three-way.
That's cool.
Yeah.
God, it sounds great, man.
Thank you.
Well, very cool. And so that is your number one in the studio as well as touring?
I would say it's the one I feel most comfortable with playing live, and I think just because I don't have to think about it. Seems like with Gibsons a lot of times, because I didn't grow up playing Gibsons or guitars that have a lot of different functions.
Right.
I get lost in the four knob thing system, and I'm like down, up, left-handed, upside down, right-handed, because the knobs are also reversed. And
right.
If I'm playing, sometimes I'll play Epiphone or a Gibson where the knobs will be up here.
Right.
And I'll get used to the way that it turns.
Yeah.
And then I'll switch to a lefty, and then it's the opposite, and I can't remember that live. So
right.
Anyway, I feel really comfortable playing this. I don't have to think about it.
Yeah.
But in the studio, I use all kinds of guitars. On my record, I used I used this, you know, on half the stuff on my new album, but I also used a Guild Aristocrat, which is one of my favorite guitars. It's like a 60 or 59 or 60.
Cool.
And then an Epiphone, like a 64 Epiphone Casino.
Oh, cool.
On the record.
Was that a right or a left?
They were right. Usually I'll use right-handed guitars in the studio because they're available.
Right.
And I can sit down and play, so I don't have to worry about the strap and the button and the knobs being on this side and turning them down with my arm.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. You know, it's I don't know if you've seen that Hendrix on the Mike Douglas thing when he's playing this SG, but you can see him kind of like has this work again, like he's kind of stumbling a little bit with the controls because he's so used to the Strat thing, you know, and he just recently switched over. I think that the guitar he just like got.
Well, the interesting thing about Jimmy was that the reason that he could play a right-handed body with the knobs up here is because his limbs were so long. So his limb actually went down here past this and also past the tremolo bar, the whammy bar.
Yeah.
So he could get past all that. It never got in the way because his arms were so long and they came up this way. Whereas mine actually don't even make it that far.
Right. Yeah, you're right. I've never thought of that. I'm sure that made a huge difference. You know?
The thing that I don't understand about Jimmy is he played a right-handed guitar, so that means that right here is where it stopped for him.
Right.
But yet he got all the way up here, so I'm not sure how he made that jump with those fingers.
I think he just had really big fingers, I think, you know.
Big everything.
Yeah, more than likely. Right. Well, that's too cool, man. Well, tell me about these cool amps here.
I've been playing some different stuff for this tour. I had a lot of different tones on my new album, and I tried to get, you know, as much of those tones live as I could. So this is actually a new thing that I'm trying out. That's my Super, which is a modded Super, high-powered speakers. And
cool. What year is that?
You know, it's like a late 70s thing, which is not my thing, but I disconnected the master on it, so it's, you know, more like a
Black Faces. Yeah.
This is a Analog Outfitters, and it's, I guess, the parts from a B3 and a reverb tank from that. And they just sort of assemble all these old parts and put them in this box, and it gives you that Leslie sound.
Right. Yeah.
The slow speed is pretty amazing. It just gives like the best chorus sound ever.
That's great. So, and I guess, is there a foot control that brings it, that speeds it up and slows it down, or is it just...
There is. I don't have that foot control yet, but there is one that does that.
Yeah, that's so great. I love that, like, drive shaft looking thing.
Yeah.
Sitting around. That's great. Did you use that on the album as well?
No, I didn't. I used a real Leslie.
Oh, yeah. Cool. Yeah. That's great. So, that's running into the old Super.
Yeah, the Super's powering this, because this acts more like a pedal. It's just like a massive pedal. So that's just in the chain. And then Blankenship, who is a LA-based amp maker, made this amp for me, which is, I used to play 100-watt super basses.
Yeah.
But I wanted that sound, but I wanted to have it in a smaller box, and also to try and be a little less loud,
right?
Because vocally, you know, I need to level down on stage a bit.
Sure. Yeah.
I mean, and this still is really, really loud. But I'm running this head, which is a 50-watt version of a super bass.
Yeah.
Through the 212 cab.
Oh, great.
The Fender cab.
Great. And is that a
bass breaker?
Bass breaker.
Cab, yeah.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah, in the Archangels, that was a super bass days.
No,
right?
In the Archangels, I used two Blackface Twins.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Wow. I bet that was a
10.
Loud band.
Yeah.
That was a loud band.
It was a loud band.
I never saw you all, but yeah.
I gave myself tinnitus or tinnitus,
yeah.
Depending on where you're from.
Right.
Yeah, I got that from one night. I did a solo, and I think it was on, we did a cover of Street Fighting Man.
Oh,
the Stones.
Great.
And the solo on that is just a feedback note, and it holds a note. Keith holds a note for like, it seems like a minute or so.
Right.
And so I played that note, and I decided to put my head or my ear right next to the speaker, and I just held it there for about a minute. And I've had, you know, ringing in my ear for
ever since.
30 years and 24 years.
You know, a rock and roll casually.
Yeah. I meant it.
Right. That's great. Yeah. That's great. So kids, be warned. That's part of the price of it. Well, cool, man. Well, that all sounds great. Let's talk about your pedals.
All right.
Okay, so Doyle, your quarter inch running in over here. And where's it go from there?
Well, that's a very good question. The person that made this pedal board recently for me is named Dave Phillips, and he has a company called LA Sound Design, and he's just one of the great pedal board makers in the probably in the world. And he put this together where all the pedals work really well together, so I can use overdrives and fuzzes and multiple fuzzes on with the overdrive as well, and a clean boost or whatever I'm doing, and everything, it just all works really well together. And I'm not sure how he makes that happen, but he's really good at figuring that out.
Wow. And it is so clean, man.
I mean, it is very clean and it's durable.
Yeah. Is this did you just have this built for this tour? Did you have Clapton as well?
Yeah, he helped me quite a bit figure out this, and I know that he works with you know, a lot of people. I actually met him through John Shanks, who's a producer in Los Angeles and great guitar player. But yeah, he hipped me to Dave, and then you know, Dave's worked with Michael Landau and you know, a lot of great people. So anyway, so what we sort of put together on here was, I guess it's, these are sort of my two go-tos here, are the Prescription Electronic pedals. This is a Cobb pedal made by Prescription Electronics, and then this is an Experience pedal, which all of these are no longer made anymore, but they're sort of, you know, fuzz octave pedals.
Right.
That, you know, get completely different tones, but and this is a Third Stone, which is made by Burkos FX, and he usually takes like a lot of the germanium parts, and he'll make like Dallas Arbiter fuzzes, and then this, which is more like the later Jimmy fuzz, like Woodstock fuzz. This is the Univibe, which is called Vibro, a Austin-based company makes this.
Cool.
It's the best Univibe that I've heard that isn't the real thing, you know, isn't the original, rather.
Right. Do you have one of the originals at home or in your studio?
No, I think I ended up selling that a long time ago when I needed to, but this thing, this thing is exactly the same, you know. Right.
Oh, that's. Wow, that sounds great.
Yeah.
And it kind of freaks me out watching you play backwards like that. Yeah. Yeah, that sounds killer, man. Okay, cool.
So that one, this was actually a pedal that I used on my record, which was sort of a secret weapon thing here that I'm giving away right now. But it's called the Zonk Machine. And I think the original pedals that they make are, there's something like $5,000 a pedal, because there aren't that many left. And it's an English fuzz, and it's sort of a wacky kind of sound because it has like a real sizzle on the top of it. Oh. And it sounds a bit like the amps blowing up.
Wow.
But and it's loud. You ready?
Yeah. That's crazy, man. It sounds like your verb went way up when you turned it.
Yeah, no, I gotta get that in check.
I think it's, wow. Well, if that's a $5,000 pedal, then your secret is safe.
Yeah, I know, right? Yeah. Well, this particular one wasn't $5,000, but I found one actually, you know, through a guy that helped produce part of my record. This guy, Woody Jackson.
Yeah.
But he's in LA at Vox Studios. He hit me to this, and he's like, "Man, you're gonna use this on the record if you." And I did. So.
God, that's killer, man! What a great sound. Okay, cool.
This is actually a one that I really dig and use quite a bit. But it's an overdrive. But it's so punchy, and it's, you know, basically does what a tube screamer tries to do, but I just think it does it better. And that's Janray.
Okay, yeah. Janray.
So it's just,
wow, that's great. Yeah, what a cool pedal, man.
I think there's some natural reverb in this room, too.
Yeah.
Happening.
Yeah, this is a very live room.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Awesome. Okay. Cool. I love every tone.
And then the Spring Chicken, which is made by Maleco, I think, company.
Yeah.
Just a spring reverb.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, they make a really good spring.
Great. Yeah, killer.
And I don't know what the chain or order is, but it sounds good. And then this is a 68.
Oh, cool.
Vox wah.
Killer, man.
And then if you want to get super aggressive and get sort of the Jimmy vibe, you can use that Univibe with the third stone.
Yeah.
And you can use the Janray too, actually.
I just like that sound right there. Yeah. God, that is great, man. Yeah, awesome. I would just want to leave that on all the time.
Yeah.
No, you know, it's funny because I think it comes from, you know, being producing and having a mind that sort of is always thinking about that. But, you know, obviously pedals are really fun. I'm a freak, as you can tell, for different sounds. But, you know, none of that stuff can really help you if you don't have like good melodic sense or good ideas or
whatever. Totally.
And
and you plug straight in.
You know, I think being able to play without pedals in the beginning and just really, you know, get a sense of how to get tone just through, you know, guitar through an amp is pretty important too.
Oh yeah.
You know, because this is all just like elaborate, you know, elaborating on whatever it is you're hearing.
Like. On the Archangel days, I imagine you had a pretty Spartan rig.
It was a bit less than this. Yeah. I think it was the Archangels. It was a Dallas Arbiter fuzz, which is actually I put inside this thing.
Oh
here.
Wow!
That exact,
you just
that
smashed
exact
it
pedal.
Down. Yeah. Really, that's cool.
The guy from Burkos did that.
Oh,
he
cool.
Put the inside because you know inside this big you know
right,
spaceship.
Huge.
Looking thing, it's just like these three little parts.
God.
So I just put it inside that.
Good idea.
But I think it was just Dallas Arbiter fuzz. I had a Univibe, Echoplex, and I had a Ross flanger.
Oh, cool.
One that you plug in.
Yeah.
And that thing sort of had a Leslie kind of,
you
know, tone to it.
Yeah.
So.
Cool. And then, what is this mysterious yellow thing?
This is just a tremolo.
Oh, cool.
This particular one's made by JHS.
Oh, yeah, they're great.
And...
Yeah, it's great. Cool. Yeah, it sounds great. And then Nemesis delay looks
like. Yeah, I'm trying this out. It's a good sound of delay.
Yeah. That sounds great. We reviewed that and it was there was so much stuff on it. It was like, I mean, there's a lot of stuff.
There is.
Kind of overwhelming.
Yeah, I only used one actually.
Yeah.
Because I don't know how to.
Right.
I don't know how to change it when I'm actually playing. But the reverse, I actually got it for the reverse sound too. Oh yeah. Oh, that's great. Yeah.
Yeah, too cool. Yeah. Yeah, man, those are all just great tones. Yeah. So do you find yourself using all of them throughout the course of a night or
depends on like pretty much. Yeah, I use them on, I mean, this one's down at the moment because I think I left it in my car too long and overheated, so the germanium thing is melted or dead or something. So I mean, but yeah, I use pretty much everything every night.
Yeah, kind of. It sounds
not all at the same time, but different songs.
Might be kind of fun to put them all on. Yeah.
Well, I mean, that's the interesting thing about that guy, Dave Phillips, who I was talking about, because he somehow, you know, patches them all together where they all work with each other.
Oh, that's great. So. Yeah, that's killer. And then so you're running this tone bone to switch between amps?
Yeah, because I just got the analog outfitters box, so I have to switch between the super reverb and that.
Can you get them both at the same time, or is it one or the other?
I probably could, but I don't really need to do that because I'm not running them stereo.
Yeah.
So.
Oh yeah, that's with, great.
That's with the Univibe and the Vibro and the Leslie thing.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah. That's interesting.
Right. Oh yeah. God, that's killer, man. Yeah. Wow. Well, Doyle, this has really been great, man. Just great hearing you play. You're a great player, you know.
Thank you.
Great producer, great artist, the whole enchilada.
I don't know what I'm talking about, but maybe somebody will find it interesting.
Yeah, well, hey, man, congratulations on the new album, and, you know, enjoy the tour.
Yeah, thanks, man. Thank you.
Cheers, man.
All right.
Till next time.
Don't forget to sign up for PG Perks, your all-access pass to exclusive gear giveaways and discounts on PremierGuitar.com.